Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Shaping Your Future Report launch webinar. We're delighted to have so many of you join us this morning. I'm Andrew Griggs, Senior Partner at Kreston Reeves, and I'll be chairing our one-hour session today. During this webinar, we'll be launching the results from our nationwide survey of over 650 business leaders, which will be followed by a discussion where our panel will explore key themes and provide guidance and recommendations. But before we get started, I just wanted to explain why we have carried out this research. We know the environment is incredibly tough for businesses. It has never been so uncertain. And whilst there have been many signs of a strong V-shaped recovery coming out of the pandemic, there are some concerns. The last 18 months has led to increased savings, but consumer spending may not have been as high as anticipated due to potentially higher inflation. We've seen the latest inflation results, as well as increased taxes next year, making people a little apprehensive. And similarly for businesses, whilst welcoming the super deduction tax incentive, and many may feel held back by rising taxes, employment and goods costs, as well as supply chain delays. Businesses need to work at being leaner and increasing productivity, which in turn will give them greater confidence. The impact of the pandemic and Brexit is likely to continue to bring new challenges and change. But with change comes an incredible amount of opportunity. It's important that we focus our guidance on the issues that matter most to businesses. We wanted to seek and share the experiences and views of business leaders to provide focused insight and advice that helps businesses navigate the new environment, face the challenges it brings, and grasp opportunities and shape their future. We're going to be hearing now from Andrew Tate, who's our head of restructuring and transformation, and he's going to be giving us the summary of the key findings from our Shaping Your Future report. Now, there are some interesting results here as we go through, and these will be explored as we go through the rest of the session. So, Andrew.
Great. Thank you very much, Andrew, and good morning, everyone. So we surveyed 652 business leaders across the UK during the first 2 weeks of October 21. 51% of the businesses were based in London or the Southeast, and the majority of the businesses had $1 million to $25 million turnover. The respondents largely had between 51 and 500 employees, and they came from a wide range of sectors. And you can see on the slide the percentage of companies that were in the various sectors. So just moving on, it's a tough economic climate out there. There are loads of variables, as we all know, but it's not all negative. 33% of our respondents felt Brexit positively affected their business, and 29% stated that COVID actually has a positive effect. But cash was king during the pandemic, so how is that now? Well, 64% of respondents have higher or consistent cash reserves. About a third, 36%, report lower cash reserves, and 74% of respondents made use of the COVID cash flow support. But interestingly enough, 20% of those don't expect to be able to repay that borrowing, and we suspect that's probably mostly the bounce back loans. So the next point that we asked about were top business priorities. What were these? Firstly, in the last 18 months, and then secondly, in the next 24 months. And I think you can see from the slides there that the top business priorities perhaps are not unusual, in that it's retaining clients, it's getting new clients, but interestingly, it's retaining existing employees. And certainly from that point of view, we're finding that the employment shortage that we have at the moment is really causing issues for businesses. So moving forward, we were interested to learn about the confidence in the economy from businesses. And actually, it's a really good news story. 87% of businesses are either confident or very confident for the future. They're ambitious, they're optimistic for growth. 39% expect to see turnover increase by up to 25%, and 27% actually expect to see growth of between 26 and 50% over the next 12 months. So that's really encouraging for our economy, given all the challenges that we have out there. So there are some challenges, and we asked our audience to say what factors they would see as the main constraints on future growth. And it's probably not a great surprise to see supply chain issues right at the top there, and we'll come back to that. Employee retention, again, as I've just said, there's real shortage of labour in our market at the moment. Increase in competitor activity and limited markets and acquiring new customers. All of that speaks of perhaps innovation by businesses and businesses pivoting to take on new markets. Interestingly, 16% of businesses believe that they have no factors constraining their growth. But looking at the supply chain, is the top of that list of factors constraining growth, and it's a real issue. So we wanted to find out some more. And only 24% of businesses are not experiencing supply chain issues. 37% report supply chain delays have been between 3 to 6 months, 24% over 6 months, and 3% actually over 12 months delay. That's quite difficult for businesses to cope with. And 62% are expecting the disruption that they're facing to hit profitability by up to 10%. 29% are expecting a hit to profitability of between 11 and 25%. So a real hit on margins for our businesses. But businesses are adapting to this, and they're coming up with multiple strategies to deal with this. 45% are looking for greater collaboration between customers, competitors, and suppliers. 34% are looking to acquire key components of their supply chain. So it's really interesting. Moving to a slightly different area and one close to our hearts, we wanted to find out more about how businesses interact with their people and what their expectations of the future are. Staff numbers look to remain relatively consistent. The majority of businesses have adopted and look very favourably on hybrid and flexible working conditions. 27% of businesses offer no form of incentive programme at the moment. That may be something for them to look at. And 51% of businesses are to a great extent, and 36% to some extent, becoming more socially responsible or purpose-led. And we think the purpose is really important for businesses to maintain their relationships, both internally and externally. So with such interesting information provided about business growth and confidence, we thought we'd find out how that growth would be funded. So future plans are funded primarily through retained growth, that's 33% of our respondents, and organic growth, which was 30%. 56% of businesses are exploring M&A opportunities in the next 12 months, and 31% of those are looking for strategic growth, but 19% are looking to protect their market position, and that's a fascinating dynamic for us. 46% of businesses have taken advantage of research and development tax credits, but 10% actually haven't come across that concept before, and it would be well worth investigating. So finally, before I hand back to Andrew, with an ever-increasing trend towards digital accounting and HMRC's push to interact with taxpayers digitally, we thought we'd find out how many businesses use online accounting software and whether they use the full capabilities of the technology available. So 21% of businesses don't use online accounting software, and 63% of those who don't use it at the moment are still not planning to over the next 6 months. We think it's a real opportunity for businesses to get involved in this technology. Of those who do use the software, there's probably still more that they can do with it. 37% don't use it for cash flow planning, 39% don't use it for the scenario planning, and 50% don't use it to utilize AI. So again, there's plenty of opportunity for businesses to be able to really get into that tech platform and use it to its full extent. So Andrew, I will now pass back to you.
Fantastic, Andrew, and thank you very, very much for that canter through lots and lots of very useful information, which we hope our audience will find useful. And I'd now like to introduce our panel of experts to you all ahead of our discussion. You should be seeing them on screen now. So we're delighted to also be joined by our guest panelists, Judy Kapsalis from Coaster Capital and Pam Loch from Loch Associates. Thank you both very much for joining us this morning. And from Kreston Reeves, we have Rupert Moyle, partner and head of VAT and Duty, Laurence Parry, tax partner, Jennifer Williamson, accounts, tax and outsourcing partner, Jack Clipsham, corporate finance partner, Richard Spofforth, head of accounts and outsourcing partner, Rachel Emmerson, accounts senior manager, and Emily Baldwin, our outsourcing manager. Thank you all very much, panel, for joining us this morning. So firstly, to begin our discussion, I would like to ask Andrew, Richard, Pam, and Rupert to stay on screen, and we'll see the other panelists reappear shortly. So to follow on from our survey findings, businesses have identified a variety of constraints to their growth, and different businesses will face different challenges. There are, however, some common core constraints that have been identified in our report, including supply chain issues, as Andrew said, employee retention, and increase in competitor activity. Andrew, as supply chain is the biggest constraint for businesses at the moment, as you just said, shall we start with what businesses can do to help address these challenges? I think you're muted, Andrew.
Sorry about that. So I think that the from an accounting point of view and what we can really help our clients with, I think what we really see here is that the supply chain issues are causing a hit on margin. We're seeing prices of raw materials, we're seeing freight prices going through the roof, and of course, you know, we're seeing inflationary pressures coming in the economy as well. So I think from our point of view, it's really businesses looking ahead to the pinch points that they might have from a cash flow point of view, and addressing that at an early stage with their funders, looking as to how they're going to deal with those. And there are lots of other things that businesses should be doing, and obviously the relationship with their suppliers is absolutely critical. But from an accounting point of view, and that's where we're looking to bring our expertise in, that's the real killer issue.
Thank you, Andrew. And you mentioned in relationship with suppliers, so that's a people issue. So I will move on to Pam. Pam, employee retention and attracting people are also key issues, as was highlighted, as well as priorities of businesses. Can you explain what the issues are here and what businesses can do to help address them?
Well, Andrew, as solicitors and HR consultants, we're at cutting edge of experiencing this, and it's an extremely challenging labour market at the moment, both from a recruitment point of view and from a retention perspective. As a result of COVID, staff have been re-evaluating their lives. And we found from surveys undertaken by Microsoft with 30,000 people globally, 41% are thinking about changing their job or profession. And in the UK, The Guardian did a very recent survey and said one in four are thinking about changing job. So there are challenges there in terms of retaining your staff. And you shouldn't make assumptions that you know your staff, because things have changed quite a bit. So we're doing quite a lot of staff surveys to try and really establish what staff are looking for. And therefore, you can then try and make sure you retain the good quality staff. Other things you need to think about are being potentially more flexible, because there's no doubt people are looking for more flexible hybrid working arrangements as well. And the best thing to do then is, obviously, from a recruitment point of view, is also to move pretty swiftly, because we are noticing that people are not waiting for second or third interviews. They're grabbing the opportunities to take the job. So one of the things you do need to think about is, as I say, moving swiftly, but not being desperate, because we're also seeing the other side of the coin where employers have made mistakes and they've recruited people into the business and it's destabilized their teams, which then impacts on you retaining your good quality staff. So it's really important to think about these things. And just a couple other points to think about is be attractive as possible. Think about how you're presenting your business on websites, social media. Are your staff advocating you as an employee to work for? So these are some of the things that I think you need to think about. And also, think about, as I say, other ways in which you can think out the box in terms of recruitment. We've got a client who's struggling to find temps at the moment, and they've targeted the Brazilian community in the city they work in, because they actually think that's a group of people that might be interested in temporary jobs. So they're going to Brazilian churches, putting up posters, trying to speak to people. and also look at younger workers and older workers. Now, when I say older, it's only those over 50. But, you know, what you can look at is a group of people that have suffered quite badly during the COVID pandemic, but there is a supply there. So think about going out of the box, as I say, and just thinking about it in a different sense and, you know, consider those groups of workers as a supply, resolution at the moment.
Thank you, Pam. So the key takeaway from that about people is thinking out of the box, which as we're in this new situation, I think is a very relevant comment. Many organisations have been conserving cash. 36% of businesses have reported lower cash reserves now than at the start of the pandemic. And a fifth of the businesses that made use of the COVID cash flow support do not expect to be able to repay the borrowing. Andrew, what can businesses do? What are the options available to them?
Not being able to repay a bounce back loan is actually quite a serious thing, and it's something that businesses really need to take quite seriously. And the reason I say that is because the government have quite clearly laid out that they're going to be looking very closely at these situations. So businesses really need to look at that carefully. They should be taking some advice. If they believe at this stage that they're not able to repay the bounce back loan or the CBILS loan for that matter, they should be talking to people like myself and looking at what their options are. And they should be taking early steps if they're not able to repay those liabilities, to also be speaking to the bank. The banks are there to support us. Some people don't necessarily see that, but they are there to support. The banks have to do everything that they possibly can to recover the money before the government will step in and honour the guarantee. So it's take advice and really look at what the options are. There's lots of options if a business gets to a situation like this at an early stage.
Fantastic. Thank you. And I guess if the last couple of years have taught us anything, it's that change, often unexpected, is our new norm, and whatever that might be at the moment. So what can businesses do to help sort of, because businesses like certainty and we're in uncertain times, but what can they do to plan ahead and prepare for continuing challenges and uncertainties? Richard, I'll come to you.
Thank you, Andrew. I think for the 10 years running up until the pandemic, businesses have been really focused on planning for growth in a strong economy. And I think now, many businesses are poised for what I'd term as recovery growth. But as we saw, quite often we got less cash. That was sort of 36% or so. But I think those who might have reported slightly higher cash are not factoring in the fact they've got a bounce back loan or a CBILS loan that they need to repay as well. Starting off with this cash flow reserves or slightly weaker balance sheets, we've also got this labour shortage that Pam talked about, longer lead times for goods. And we can see that coming through where people have moved to just-in-time production. And obviously now things like chip shortages are stopping people from being able to supply cars. So people are starting to stock up in order to meet their customer demands. And generally that means longer working capital cycles for businesses. I think if we throw in CBILS loan repayments, deferred VAT repayments, some cost push inflation and higher interest rates, you can quickly see now why projections and scenario planning are really going to help business owners to make good decisions. And I'd sort of summarise that it's never too early to plan and then start course correcting as things pan out.
And I think that's right, Richard. It's planning, but remaining agile with those plans as we're in this uncertain environment. Thank you. So, Rupert, businesses trading with the EU have made some adjustments to cope with the new VAT and duty rules since we left the EU on the 1st of January. What are the key messages in managing supply chain issues as well?
Thank you, Andrew. Well, I think it's about change. Where the supply chain issues, you may need to change the structure of your business, perhaps where you buy goods from, for example. We saw with Phil's presentation earlier that there's difficulties with imports. So a business might change, for example, instead of buying from a UK business, instead they might buy materials from direct from an Italian supplier and ship it direct to their customer in the EU. And whilst that was all very easy pre-Brexit, which I know if businesses will have planned for, that doesn't mean to say that those future changes will be covered by the planning that's been done. So although business leaders will come up with some excellent ideas on how to solve problems. Remember that your finance team need to get compliance issues sorted out. Yeah. An example, if you buy goods from Italy and send them direct to your customer in, say, the Netherlands, whereas before there'd be no VAT charge by the Italian supplier or yourselves in the UK, and the customer would simply acquire the goods and self-account for VAT. Now, that scenario, which was called triangulation, won't work. There's going to be a need for a UK business to either register for VAT in Italy or the Netherlands. So really, it's about considering the changes and not just relying on the planning that you've done for Brexit. I think the second point is about making sure that any changes you make, you've sorted out your contracts and your shipping terms, your income terms. And I think the final point is, remember, you know, we've got a border with the EU, and that means that even though you might have thought you've got your compliance issues sorted out, actually getting the goods through customs, the clearance issues are really quite tricky, could result in establishments or appointing an indirect agent. So watch out for those too.
Fantastic, Rupert. Thank you very much. I'm keen to move on. And I know there are some detailed questions still to come. So thank you very much, panel. I'd now like to ask Laurence, Jennifer and Judy to join us as we dive into people, purpose and the future of work. So given that employee retention and talent acquisition is a key priority and issue, we were surprised that 27% of businesses we surveyed said they do not offer incentives to motivate or reward staff. Pam, how important is this and what are the options for businesses to consider?
Well, it's really important nowadays, particularly with the problems around retention and obviously recruitment as well, because staff are looking at what you're offering in terms of the package you're offering. So you should be reviewing your salary and your benefits, and you should be benchmarking, and we're doing that for a lot of clients at the moment, because the market is moving, as Phil mentioned earlier, and I think there will be continuing shifts in wages as well. So I think you should be thinking about investing in your staff as well, thinking about training and development. Also think about creating clear career pathways to try and retain them. That doesn't cost any money really to do that, but it gives people an avenue in which they can sort of focus their attention to remain with you. And there's other things that you can do that don't cost a lot of money. Praising your staff. Sometimes we forget to say thanks, and doing that in public makes such a big impact on staff. So, you know, you can introduce Employee of the Month awards if you want to spend some money on it. But also other things that you can think about are mentoring younger staff and doing reverse mentoring with older staff involved as well. So again, you're getting engagement there from your entire team. And obviously wellbeing is a massive thing, and it will be for some time to come in the future. So think about, you know, doing some mental health training so you've got first aiders, so they're able to identify issues. And also think about things that are not expensive, but actually could impact significantly in retaining staff and also helping reduce absences. And that's an employee assistance programme. It is very, very cheap. We set it up for clients. It ticks the legal box in terms of looking after your staff from a health and safety perspective as well. You can also be quite innovative and stand out from the crowd and think about having things like a menopause policy, so that you actually then appeal to a wider group of people. And as I say, it's not just in the retention, but it's also from the recruitment point of view, because people are asking, what have you currently got in place for your staff? How do you look after your staff? How do you value them?
Fantastic, Pam. And I think reassuring to hear that it's not just about the money, it's about behaviour as well. So thank you very much. But Laurence, moving on to you, there are some alternative methods of motivating people, or additional ones, I should say, including share schemes, employee management incentives and EOTs. Can you briefly talk us through these and how they could benefit businesses?
Of course. I mean, I could talk actually for quite a long time about these, but I'll try and keep it brief. The first point is, as Pam said earlier, don't assume you know your employees. What works for employee A may not work for employee B. And the other point is, actually, this webinar is called Shaping Your Future. You need to understand what you as business owners want your future to be, and your employee incentivization and motivation needs to be, in the jargon, goal congruent with what you want. If you're wanting to sell in 5 years, the motivation and retention tools may be different than if you're looking at a lifestyle business and you want to keep the cash. So within that background, you ask those three things. So share schemes, you tie your employee into the equity. An EMI scheme is the best of breed of a share scheme. It gives the employees 10% tax on sale and gives you a tax deduction for what you give them with basically no cash. It only happens on a sale. An EOT is just a wrap around all these different things. And quite often you will have a EMI scheme, possibly an unapproved share scheme if you don't qualify, and also an EOT. So they're all tools in the box that you use to keep this motivation and retention going.
Fantastic, Laurence. 87% of businesses we surveyed said they were becoming increasingly socially responsible and purpose-led. And this shift is increasingly evident. I'm really interested in the panel's views and thoughts on this. Given these changing times, how important is it to businesses and what can and should they be doing to support this? Jen, can I come to you?
Thank you, Andrew. So we've heard about lots of ways to incentivise employees and engage with customers, but you're right, it's becoming increasingly important to evidence that you have values that align and that create this connection, because it's no longer about what you do or how you do it, but about why you do it. So we've heard about the labour market heating up and a competitive salary no longer being enough, and there's much more choice in the market. So employers really need to elevate their offering. We saw in Andrew Tate's slides that the top two priorities for businesses coming out of our survey are retaining customers and employees. And we know from experience that purpose-led businesses have a stronger brand, and that can make them really well placed to address those priorities. The next question we often hear is, well, I've defined my personal or business purpose, but how do I evidence that? So it's really important to remember two things. First is that purpose is authentic, really authentic, true to what you value, and that you embed it in everything you do. And businesses can also evidence their commitment to their purpose through their contribution to CSR and ESG goals. We know that CSR and ESG have been victims of the pandemic, with just 9% of businesses seeing it as a priority. But businesses that now make an effort to refocus on these areas really do have an opportunity to retain and grow their market share. And speaking to our own experience on this, we found that looking at the 17 UN sustainable goals and picking those that we felt most relevant to our purpose was a really great starting point for guiding our CSR and ESG agenda.
Fantastic, Jen. There's a great message in there that organisations should be thinking about why, in terms of people, customers and suppliers. It's a huge area. But you also touched on CSR and ESG as a priority. And our report showed that those areas have been sidelined a little bit. I wanted to again ask the panel's views on this. And could this be due to the necessity of competing priorities? Are businesses focusing enough on this? Julie, can I come to you for your thoughts, please?
Yeah, thanks, Andrew. I think it is disappointing to see that slight decline. But actually, for many of the businesses that I've been working with and talking to, you're right. I think this is because there have been competing priorities. But some of it, I think, is actually that businesses have been doing some great work that's more inward facing. And other colleagues on the panel reflected on businesses really having to focus over the last 18 months on supporting their own workforce and the challenges that they were facing in juggling working from home and caring responsibilities. And actually, there's some great practice in those areas that I think just haven't been recorded in the same way. But I am very keen that we support businesses to re-energise their work on ESG and CSR, as it is so important. And as others have said, it's really important for how people are choosing organisations and companies they want to work for, work with and buy from. One of my reflections on businesses I work with is that the recent climate change conference in Glasgow has undoubtedly raised the debate and the profile and set clear challenges to us all personally and our businesses to change our behaviours. And our advisors within our business support programmes at Coast Capital and Hothouse programme we've seen a huge number of inquiries from businesses saying, you know, what can we do? We recognise that we need to do more in terms of understanding our carbon footprint and our responsibility to our environment. Can you help us? And so, you know, there are some great grants out there. There's the Locase grant that can support businesses. So I think it's important to get that dialogue going and to share best practice, because a lot of SMEs that I speak to, they want to do something, but they need support in coming up with ideas, connect them with a project in the community, tell them how they can offset their carbon footprint. And so I'm really keen that we come together more and we share those ideas to have that really important impact.
Thank you, Julian. If it's one thing that I've noticed through the pandemic, I think people have been keen to work together and help each other coming through. But if I could stay with you, Julie, to help businesses prepare for the future, from all your research, what do you think the future of work in the UK will look like? And what can businesses do to help themselves prepare for that?
Yeah, oh, that there was an easy answer that just summarised that all for us. But, you know, undoubtedly, you know, COVID has accelerated the digital revolution and the use of automation. In my day job working in the further education sector, I would say for many colleges, you know, automation and digital has probably accelerated by 5 years where we had planned to be in terms of online teaching and learning. And I think the key thing actually that links to that is around skills, and not just what the workplace of the future will look like, you know, physically in where we work from, but the skills that will be needed for the future. And I think that's absolutely critical. And I think we need to do more work in this area. We need to bring together our colleges, our universities, and our businesses to really work together by individual sectors, that future sort of, you know, crystal ball gazing, what will it look like, and how do we train young people, retrain and upskill the existing workforce, bring people back into the workforce, whether that's because they've lost their job or people returning after childcare or caring responsibilities. And that's something I'm really passionate about, and I'm leading a project for the region to seek to develop an institute of technology to do exactly that, to bring together training providers and businesses to be looking 2, 5, 10 years in advance, and then to be looking at how do we develop new courses and qualifications, because one of the biggest issues is courses and qualifications don't even exist in some of these areas that we need. And so we need to work with awarding bodies to totally change the types of things that are being taught. And the last thing I'd say is how they're being taught. One of the things we've very much learned over the last 18 months is that some people, remote learning, they prefer it. They're able to fit it in around other responsibilities. They don't have to drive long distances to go to college or university. Others have absolutely missed that face-to-face interaction. What we have to do is give people choices and offer a variety of ways for people to access skills and training. And then you can apply that also to the world of work, different ways for people to perform at their best, making the most of technology.
Thank you, Julie. So the key message for me from what you've just said is giving people choice, or as I call it, managing the clevers. We're now going to move on and talk about a little more about business growth, finance and funding. So if Rachel and Jack can join us, please. So businesses in the survey have predicted incredibly optimistic growth over the next 12 months, which is a strong indication of business confidence. They largely say growth will be funded through retained profits and organic growth. But what are other methods are available to businesses? And what can businesses do to help support and achieve these growth aspirations? Rachel, can I come to you first? And what funding is available for businesses?
Yeah, of course. I think it's really interesting, actually, the results that came out of the survey, and it highlights historically the mindset of owner-managed businesses in that they do want to grow organically or from the reserves that they have in the business already. There's always been a bit of a mindset of don't buy what you can't afford. But actually, I think our job as advisors is to say that debt isn't always bad. And as we come out of the pandemic and businesses do look to grow, there's real opportunity to use some funding options to help support that I think Andrew Tate said earlier that cash is king. And as you grow, you will find that your working capital, that spare cash you've got in the bank, there'll be an open plug hole and it will just drain. So there's many, many options that you can think about in advance in order to build up those cash reserves. So some of the main ones out there at the moment, invoice financing often mirrors your turnover. Sounds scary, really isn't, if you have the right advisor to explain it to you and how it could work. Asset finance. So don't purchase something all in one go. So for example, a van, spread it out over the life of that van. So you're matching the cost with the turnover that it's generating. It just leaves that cash balance left in your bank so you can use it to invest in other things. And finally, look at any grant options that are available. There's many, many grants available at the moment. Look to your local authority and any business contacts that you've got that might be able to help you.
Lovely. Thank you very much, Rachel. And Jack, moving to you, what finance opportunities are there out there for businesses and what other sources of finance are available?
Yeah, thank you, Andrew. The corporate finance market at the moment is incredibly active, unusually so, and it's across a variety of transactions. So at one level, we've got the capital markets being exceptionally busy. We've recently been told that there are just 30 companies that are already waiting in the list to list on AIM alone. That's the alternative investment market. But we're also being told that the institutional investors have funds available to invest in those projects. So we're expecting those to be largely very successful fundraisings. At the same time, and this is the unusual bit, that at the same time as capital markets are active, we're seeing private equity firms and family offices, a number of whom have actually raised new funds recently, who are now looking for homes for that funding. Add to that the grant funding that Rachel just mentioned, you've got the asset-based lenders, the challenger banks, and even now the high street banks are coming back into the market looking to invest into or lend to new clients as far as they're concerned. And it's creating this environment which is effectively full of funding that is available for the right projects. However, those guys are not going to give that money away. And what we are seeing is they are increasingly challenging and increasingly critical of proposals that are being put to them. So if I had one piece of advice to give to people now who are considering a fundraising, then it would be, before you go to those people, make sure that you are fully prepared to present to them. I'm afraid more so than ever at the moment, first impressions are critical, and also you really only get one shot at presenting to those organisations. So it's got to be right when you do it. Thank you.
Fantastic, Jack. Thank you. And Laurence, just briefly, we know the government tries to incentivise businesses to invest, but how can R&D tax credits help growing businesses?
So for the SME scheme, you spend £1 on R&D, resolving technical or scientific uncertainty, you can get the right circumstances, work the numbers through, 33 pence back. Real big subsidies. And it's not just those businesses you expect, life sciences and software. We had one retail financial business that had to develop their own client take on system. We claimed R&D on that. They got the money back.
Great. Thank you very much, Laurence. And Emily, Julie and Richard, if you could join us again, we're just going to explore our final point in the last few minutes around the financial digital revolution. So our survey found that 21% of businesses still don't use online accounting platforms. Emily, what are the benefits of online accounting and why is it so important for businesses?
Many benefits, such as saving time through process automation, flexible access to your finances, making tax digital compliance, are pretty well known now. These are, of course, fantastic benefits. But it gets even more exciting than this. Cloud systems go beyond your financial reporting and process. By having the systems integrated and talking to one another, you can see improvements in cash flow, process efficiency, staff retention, and customer satisfaction. Historically, it would take days, if not weeks, to prepare the analysis, the data required to make an informed business decision. In fact, many business owners would make many decisions based on gut feel alone. There are now so many powerful platforms available in the market that interlinking with not only your accounting records, but also other systems, such as point of sales, for valuable non-financial information. This allows a deeper level of insight into your finances at almost a click of a button. More informed decisions can be made at such speed to ensure you keep your business competitive.
Thank you, Emily. So there's clearly lots of software out there, but is it being used to its full potential? Richard?
I'm sadly, Andrew, I'm going to say undoubtedly no. I think we've seen quite a lot of businesses move online during the pandemic, yeah, fundamentally so that the finance team can work from anywhere. But beyond sort of web-based accounting and a bit of open banking, we don't really see a very high take-up of systems like automated purchase invoice processing, which we'd expect, frankly. This removes manual processes and increases accuracy significantly. And also, we see forward-thinking businesses using other data to aid decision-making, so looking at their financial data alongside things like Google Analytics. And also, I think Emily touched on quite sort of the cash flow and stuff, and you can now start to use predictive analytics to look at short-term cash flow forecasting, which won't just work on your average debtor days, but actually look at your customers that owe you money and work out when they're going to pay based on their past payment history. So really powerful and useful stuff that would take a long time to work out manually. And sort of touching briefly on some of Rachel's stuff, you can now link your clients or your customers to credit referencing agencies, which will alert you to problems that might be coming up and help you avert them. And you can link your own data to funding platforms, which will tell you what your opportunities for borrowing money are, if that's where you want to go, and also give you a much better credit score. So there's lots more that people can do just beyond, an online platform and open banking data feeds.
Fantastic. Thank you, Richard. And so, Julie, looking even further ahead, what would you say the future of the financial or digital revolution looks like for businesses? And what should businesses do to prepare now?
Yeah, you've given me all the really challenging future questions, haven't you? I think the future is exciting, and I'm always the optimist. And I think we have great strengths in this region and in the country, in our universities who are doing some really leading work, some fantastic businesses, SMEs, as well as our large businesses. But as I said earlier, I really believe we need to do more around collaboration, linking our businesses with the universities, colleges and schools, sharing R&D, ensuring that training is relevant and aligned to jobs, and that our young people are given the careers advice and guidance that matches where the jobs of the future will be. And I think for that next generation, the careers and the skills that will be required by different sectors will, and they are already changing. And I guess my last reflection, Andrew, would be my 10-year-old son, Hector, currently, he wants to be a lawyer, which I'm quite pleased about, because last week he wanted to be a wrestler. But in 5 or 10 years' time, what will being a lawyer look like? Will it law firms look the same? You know, could you be focusing on being a data analyst or a software developer and still be saying, you know, I'm working in law? And I think, you know, a lot of those traditional ways we've described sectors have changed so much. And I think we need to look a lot more at people's aptitudes, their skills that can work across a whole range of sectors. And I think careers advice and guidance, working in partnership with businesses, is going to be key to whatever it looks like, making sure that we're going to have the right people, because people have come through loud and clear today. Without the right people, we can't succeed.
Fantastic, Julian. And what a great note to end on. People are key to so many of the discussions we've had this morning. So can I just say a really big thank you to all our panelists. It's been a fantastic discussion, lots of information there. I know we could have spent ages on each of those questions. So I thank the panelists for giving their summaries there. That concludes our webinar. So I'd just like to say a huge thank you again to our panel, and a big thank you to our guest speakers, Phil Eckersley, Julie Kapsalis and Pam Loch, for taking the time to join us this morning. So whether you're already a client working with us or not, if anything has come out of today that you would like to discuss, please do not hesitate to get in contact with us. We really would be delighted to hear from you. That just leads me to say thank you very, very much for joining us. Stay safe and hope to see you again soon.